provide you a Merry Christmas. We'll do this Christmas song together. Hallelujah.
Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí iṣẹ́. Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí o. Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí iṣẹ́. Ẹ fi jó sí.
Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí o.
Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí iṣẹ́. Ẹ fi jó sí.
Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí
o. One more time.
Kérésìmesì tún máa dé o, ẹ̀yin ènìyàn, ẹyọ, ẹ bẹ̀rẹ̀ ẹ fi jó sí iṣẹ́.
got him motiri.
Yeah.
February, or in March, April, May, June, July, August, October, November, December. Oh no, was okay.
Ah! one more time.
Great is thy faithfulness
over me and my family.
Great, oh, great is thy faithfulness.
We worship you, Lord.
Morning by morning,
your mercies I see.
Your mercies I see.
All I have needed.
All I have needed. Thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
From the first Sunday till now, we want to declare that
you are Alpha and Omega.
We worship you, Lord.
We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised.
Come on, sing it one more time.
Wise men are still seeking Jesus today. You know, the Bible says the wise men came from the east to come and worship the King. We are also going to do that this morning because all of us here, we are wise people. Hallelujah. Oh, that your amen is not convincing. Amen. I said we are wise people. So that is why we are still seeking Him. That is why we have to continue to worship Him. We're going to worship Him with the song we have in our bulletin. You are Lord of creation, the Lord of my life, Lord of the land, Lord of the sea. You were Lord of heavens before there was time, and Lord of laws you will continue to be. Hallelujah. creation.
You are King of creation and King of my life, King of the land and the sea. You were King of the heavens before there was time. King of all kings you will be.
Seats, we will continue to reign as our King. All right, it is Christmas time, and the choir will be singing about Christmas. Praise the Lord.
Sky is filled with angels singing. below. Sing God in jubilation. Give a merry, merry toast to all of God's creation.
Somebody say it's Christmas time. Help me to announce your friend that it is Christmas time. Please tell him three times, it's Christmas time. Maybe they didn't hear you very well. Hallelujah. It's Christmas day. Can you tell the person it's Christmas day? We give glory to God for yet another Christmas. Will you please be on your feet? Let's give glory to God because it's another Christmas. On Christmas Day, I believe that there is nothing as good as you being a blessing on Christmas Day. I'd like you to bless somebody this morning as we take this very short time of prayer. And I'd like you to be true about this prayer, be real about this prayer, and pray from your heart to for the person that you are going to be praying for. We need to share some little prayer time in the course of this service. No better day to bless your brother and bless your sister around you than on Christmas Day. Take your bulletin, look at the prophetic word. That's our prayer this morning. Let's look at the prophetic word. Check your bulletin. It's there. It's just one statement. One statement taken from Psalm number 5, verse 12. One statement that is taken from Psalm number 5, verse 12. And we are going to say it together, and then we will pray it together. Amen. Amen. Are you ready? You have somebody to pray with and pray for? Are you ready? One, two, go. The Lord shall bless you and compass you with his favor. Do you believe in that prayer? Say it now like a prayer. The Lord shall bless you and compass you with his favor. Say a better amen to it. Now let that be a word coming out of you to bless that person. Go ahead and pray. Go ahead and pray. Just go ahead and pray for that person. Remember, two things are mentioned there. The blessing of God and the favor of God. Two things are mentioned there. And on a Christmas morning like this, I believe that these two things are very crucial, very critical for the life of that brother, that sister that you are praying with. That God will bless them and God will surround them with his favor. That God will encompass them with his favor. So pray like you mean it. Let favor come upon that brother. Let favor come upon that sister. Let favor come upon their families. Let favor come upon their homes. Let favor come upon the work of their hands. Let favor come upon their businesses. Let favor follow them throughout this season. In this Christmas season, let there be a flow of the favor of God upon the life of that brother, upon the life of that sister. Let there be a flow of the favor of God upon that brother, upon that sister. Ask God to bless them. I'd like you to remember that you are a prophet. Whoever you bless is blessed. I'd like you to remember that because you are a child of God, whoever you bless, they are blessed. So bless them with the blessings of God. Release the favor of the Almighty upon the endeavors of their hands. Thank you, Father. 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 Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. I'd like you to take it and another person different from that one you prayed for. We have only 6 days to the end of this year. 6 days only to the end of this year. But I tell you the truth that these 6 days are not too short to go for God to meet them at the point of their needs. There is something that is still outstanding in destiny, which Baba had planned to deliver in this year. I'd like you to pray for that person. Whatever was meant for this year will not pass you by. Before the 31st of this month, you will encounter that thing. God will drop it in your destiny. He will put it into your life. Can you pray for that person? A last minute visitation. A last moment visitation for 2016. A last moment visitation for 2016. A last moment visitation for 2016. Release the power of God upon them. Make them a magnet. Can you pray that they will become a magnet to attract a last moment blessing, a last moment visitation, a last moment touch of God, a last moment miracle, a last moment visitation of God, a last moment power, a last moment increase, a last moment promotion, a last moment good news, a last moment good news. There is a good news meant for this hour in destiny. God has purposed them for this year. They will not be carried over to the next year. Whatever was meant for this year will not be carried over into the next year. Whatever heaven had apportioned for this year
will not be carried over into the next year. The Lord himself will deliver it into their lives. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. The last prayer, I want you to pray for yourself. God, the next 6 days, I'll be alive the next 6 days to enter into the year 2017. Can I have a good amen here? Can I have a good amen here? 6 more days. These are not my last 6 days. Father, I'm crossing over into the year 2017. Listen to me. This is the last Sunday, but it's not your last Sunday. Can I have an amen in this house? This is the last Sunday, but it is not your last Sunday. You will be here next Sunday or anywhere else, but you'll be alive on the first Sunday of 2017, which also is the first day of 2017. If you agree with me, I'd like you to just lift up your right hand and pass a decree concerning the next 6 days and entering into the next year. Can you go ahead and pray? Open your mouth and speak like a prophet. Speak like a prophet. Obstacles in these 6 days, you are crossing them over. Challenges these 6 days, you are crossing them over. Sickness and disease, you are conquering them. All kinds of difficulties, you are overcoming them. Every iron bar standing on your way to hinder you from entering into the year 2017, cut them asunder, cut them asunder, cut them asunder, cut them asunder. Every iron bar standing to barricade your entry into year 2017, cut them asunder, cut them asunder. I want to pray for every member of your family. They have come to this point in the year. They will not die in the next 6 days. They have come to this part of the year. The Lord will preserve them the next 6 days. Whether they are sick in their bodies, that sickness will not overcome them in these 6 days. Even if they have gotten to this point of the year, sick in their bodies, even if they are bedridden, they have a challenge, a stroke, whatever. Whatever is that sickness, I'd like you to decree, they will not be taken over. They will not be swallowed up in these 6 days. You will cross over along with them in the year 2016 into the year 2017. Pass this decree for every member of your family. Tell them I'm carrying them along with you. Tell them I'm carrying them along with you. Oh, can you say I'm carrying them along with me into the year 2017? I'm carrying my husband. I'm carrying my wife. I'm carrying my children along with me into the year 2017. Every iron bar standing on the way, by the fire of the Holy Ghost, I cut you asunder. We are flying into the year 2017. All of us together, none missing, none broken. None missing, none broken. None broken, none missing. Every member of the family, none broken. I said none of them broken, none missing. You are going together into the year 2017. The hand of the Lord shall bring this to pass. The hand of the Lord shall bring this to pass. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, the Bible says whatever we say, if we believe in our hearts, and we do not doubt at all, we shall have whatsoever we say. We have spoken prophetically, and we decree today that blessings and favor will accompany us the next 6 days into the year 2017. Everyone standing here, whether young or old, Father, I declare today they will be part of the first day, 2017, and they will see the rest of 2017. In the mighty name of Jesus. Are there some of our brethren that are not in this service because they are ill? They can't come. Father, we decree no sickness will take any one of them. We are not ready to receive any bad news concerning any one of them between now and the next 6 days in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we are carrying them along with us into the year 2017. What you have started, you will complete it. You will finish the work of their healing. They shall be delivered from the powers of darkness and from every infirmity, and it shall be well with them in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you deliver upon the life of every one of us a last moment visitation that will translate into an unusual blessing. That will cause us, oh God, to testify on the 31st of this year, 31st of December this year, we declare testimonies will roll. in this last week, oh God, there will be a last move of God for this year in our lives that will leave us with a testimony by the 31st of this month. In the name of Jesus Christ, God, we say thank you. We give you all the glory. We celebrate your majesty. Glory be unto you, O God. In Jesus' name we have prayed. And let a living being say a big amen. Amen. Let someone who is excited in this service say a loud amen. Amen. All right, before we sit down, we'd like to prepare our hearts to receive God's word. And I'd like you to put your hands together this morning as we receive the ministry of the Reverend Solomon Ajibade to bring God's word our way. Put your hands together as we receive God's word.
Amen. Please, let's still remain standing. Let's quickly open our Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 1. We will quickly read from verse 1, entering into chapter 2, and we'll stop at verse 6. Matthew chapter 1, beginning from verse 18. We will read up to chapter 2 and stop at verse 6 in chapter 2. Matthew chapter 1, beginning from verse 18. Are we there? Okay. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as followed. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with a child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with a child and bear her son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being arose from a sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded, took to him his wife, and did not know her until she had brought forth her first son, and he called his name Jesus. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, the wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jew? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where Christ was to be born. So they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it's written by the prophet, but you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. The Lord bless his word in our life in Jesus' name. Amen. Please, let's have our seat. Father, we thank you this morning for another opportunity to hear your word. I ask, O God, that may your Holy Spirit open our hearts so that your word, O God, can do your work of healing and deliverance in our life in the name of Jesus. I ask, O God Almighty, that we will hear your word clearly and your word will do us good. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Want to give thanks to God Almighty for the opportunity to stand before God's people on such a day like this. I appreciate Pastor for the opportunity to serve and to bring God's word to God's people today. The narratives about the birth of Jesus Christ, if you notice very well, there's a series of movement. And if you observe, since the beginning of this month of December, the theme of the church on this Christmas season has been centered around the King. And this King, as we have known, is Jesus Christ. We knew that there were a series of movements that he had to undertake in order to get to this earth and to fulfill the very reason why he came into this earth. And so we saw him moving from heaven in his glory. He moved into the womb of Mary in Bethlehem. And there he moved into the cradle where he was born in the manger. From there, he was taken to Egypt. We do not know how long he spent in Egypt, but he came back from Egypt down to Nazareth. And then from Nazareth, he went into the ministry. And from the ministry, he went to the cross. From the cross, he went to the tomb. And then from the tomb, he went back to heaven. And from heaven, today, he now lives in our hearts. So why? We should ask ourselves why. Why will this King undergo such a torturous journey? Why will such a King undergo such a painful and dangerous journey? Was it just for fun? I don't think so. Was it for worldly fortune? I don't think so. Was it for fame? No. Why will this King become a wandering and homeless King and helpless on this earth and became incarnate in the womb of a woman? The season of Christmas is not all about the light, is not all about the food, is not all about the parties, is not all about the funfair. It's about the King who has a motive in his heart. In the book of Matthew that we have read, Matthew was written to the Jews. And the Jews were people who had problem with the Messiah. They do not believe that Jesus Christ, who was born in the manger, whose mother was Mary and whose earthly father was Joseph, was the Messiah. So they had a struggle. They had doubts in their hearts that how can this little boy, this one that we know whom his mother and his father were, how could he be the Messiah? And so Matthew had to respond in his gospel in order to answer the matter of the doubts in the hearts of the Jews. And in his writing, he was pointing to us to let us see that this King who had to traverse all humanity and all stratas of the universe in order to get to us did not just come just like that. He came with a motive. And so Matthew started unfolding to us the motive of this King. What was in his heart? What was the passion that kept him moving from one point to the other until he got to where he is, even at this particular moment? And so Matthew was a gospel of the King himself and was a gospel that showed us clearly the motives of the King. And so for me, in the midst of our celebration, in the midst of our jubilation this season, we must not forget the motive why this King came. Because it's very easy for the motive of the King to have been colored away, to have been pushed aside in the midst of all this celebration. In the midst of our traveling and our funfare, it is possible that the matter of the motive why the King traversed all the universe in order to get to where we are, is possible that we will forget those motives. And so this Christmas morning, I believe God is redirecting our heart to say, friends, let us look at the motive of this King who became incarnate, who became a man just because of you and I. And so we saw in the gospel that we have read, written by Matthew, he started highlighting to us the motive why this King came. In the first place, in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, he pointed out to us, he said, And she shall bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin. And so the first motive is very, very clear. And it is, for me, it is the most important reason, the most important motive why the King actually came, to deal with the matter of sin. The matter of sin that held man in the Garden of Eden. The sin that that separated man from God in the Garden of Eden, the sin that made man to become ostracized from the presence of God, the sin that removed the very image of God in man, the sin that damaged the original image of God in man, God Almighty, the King came to settle that matter. And that was why Matthew said, this King came in order to save us from our sin. And notice he said, to save his people from their sin. There's a scripture that says that we are the sheep of his pastures. And so the people that we're talking to are not just strangers. They are people who are related to him. The Jews were related to him. And that's for us today to say that he came to save us from our sin, his people. Why? Why will his people still continue to be in sin? Why will his people still continue in sin that he had to still come in order to save them from their sin? So the matter of sin is a serious matter. And it's possible that in this season of Christmas, that in the midst of our celebration, we push aside the matter of sin and just keep quiet and say, oh, all is well, the light is here. Oh, the manger is there, Joseph is there, everything is there. But friends, the very reason why he came is to deal with the matter of sin. Because he said his people, to save his people from their sin. The Jews, of course, had issues with sin. Because anytime the issues of sin are raised, they will quickly refer to Abraham. They will say, we have Abraham as our father. And so because we have Abraham as our father, there's no need for you to condemn any matter of sin. Just leave us to live our life. And Jesus said, no, the reason why I came is to deal with the matter of sin in our lives. And friends, this morning, it is better for Jesus to save you from sin than to save you in your sin. If Jesus will save you in your sin, that means sin must have done a damage in your life. You know, when Jesus Christ came, he said to save his people from their sins. To save his people from that, before you go into it, he wants to save you from it. But friends, if you happen to go into it, he will save you in your sin, but you will live with the damage that sin will have done in your life. Many a times we used to fail to recognize that for every sin that we commit, there's a consequence. There's a consequence for every sin. That's why Romans says that the wages of sin is death. So every sin we commit was supposed to bring death. But you see, when we go to 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 and 8, God forgives our sins. But friends, the consequences will be there. But what he will do again, because you are his child, is that what he will supply the grace to bear the consequences. That was what he did for David. When David sinned with Bathsheba, and Nathan came and confronted him, he said, your sins are forgiven. But what happened? He said, the sword will not leave you. So God forgave David, but gave him the grace to bear the consequence. The grace to watch his children killing one another. His children doing all kinds of evil against themselves. Friends, I don't want that one. I don't know for you. But today, God is pointing our attention to something very, very serious. It is better for Jesus to save you from your sin than to save you in your sin. That's why he came. That's why he came. I don't know if you have heard this word, but that is true, that this is the world that we are living in today. We are living in a world that seems to promote post-truth. In other words, the world is saying that truth is no longer relevant. So we can lie, we can cheat, we can do all kinds of things and think that, oh, nothing will happen. Friends, there's a consequence for every sin that is committed. Sin has infection. Sin has infected our minds, our emotions, our will, our intellect, our reasoning, our decision making, our words, our deed. No part of our life is exempted from sin. Sin has become like a good idea. A good idea. And we just live with it. And we just gloss over it. People will change record and just gloss over it. People will ask children to lie and just gloss over it. Sin has become like a good idea to us. There was a story I was reading about a young Christian who became a child of God, and then the pressures of things around him make him to compromise his faith. And so he, when his friends were getting girlfriends, he got girlfriend himself. One day the girlfriend visited him, and after they stayed together, they talked, they ate and everything. When the girl was leaving, the young man, being a Christian, decided not to do anything strange or evil, decided to just give the girl a little peck. He gave the girl a little peck, the girl left, and then after he left, the Holy Spirit started convicting him. That, do you know what you have done? And the boy could not control himself because he felt so convicted about sin. And he went to the mountain and spent 3 days on the mountain just confessing his sins, just trying to reconnect himself back to God. So he came back after 3 days of knowing that, yes, God has forgiven him. Then after some years, he was now asking a counselor. He said, why? Why is it that I don't feel the kind of conviction about sin? Why is it that I don't feel the convictions again? The counselor answered, it's because sin has become like a good idea. When we trivialize the matter of sin, what we are doing is that we are making useless the motive why the king came. He came to save us from our sin. And so this morning, every one of us needs to go back. That, why are you celebrating? Are you celebrating because you have been saved from sin? Does sin no longer have dominion over your life? Or are you celebrating in sin? If you are celebrating in sin, you are spoiling Christmas. Excuse me, you are spoiling Christmas. I was watching a cartoon with my son yesterday, and it was a group of some people who wanted to spoil Christmas for the world. And the way they wanted to do it was to make sure that Santa does not go around distributing the gift. But eventually it happened. It just struck my mind. When we sin this Christmas season, we are spoiling Christmas. Because the very reason why he came is not for you to continue to sin. No, it's for you to have a turnaround away from sin. So this Christmas, the Lord God Almighty is reminding us that sin is never a good idea. Sin is never a good idea. That is the reason why the king himself came. There was no any other person that could do the job. That was why the Bible tells us, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, God made him who had no sin to become sin so that we can become the righteousness of God. Friends, this morning, we need to reevaluate our attitude to this matter of sin. Because the very reason why this king came was to deal with the issue of sin. Do you feel convicted even when you just lie one small lie? Do you feel sober? Do you feel the pain whenever you do something that you know you ought not to have done? This morning, we need to go back to God and ask God for that grace. As sinners, we need salvation. We don't need reformation. Many times we send people to go and do reformation. Reformation is only on the surface. The matter is salvation. When a man gets saved, then the matter of sin is dealt with. We need forgiveness, not lecture on morality. We need a new life, not a new leaf, so that Jesus Christ came in order to save us from our sin. This morning, every one of us needs to go back and evaluate ourselves. What is my attitude to this matter of sin? The second reason why Jesus Christ or the King came was highlighted to us in verse 2 or chapter 2, verse 6. It said, but you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. So the second reason why he actually came was to shepherd us. To shepherd us, to guide us home safely. The shepherd has an agenda to take his sheep out and to make sure that they come back home safely. This king who came to this earth. He came in order to guide us from this earth and guide us to the eternal home. But you see, it's not everybody that will follow this shepherd. As the shepherd is calling today, as the shepherd has come today, calling, saying, friends, come under my umbrella. Come under my fold so that I can guide you safely home. Some will not. But you see, the reason why he came as a shepherd is to guide us, to guide us home. Psalm 23, the Bible says, the Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And so this season, the king came in order to shepherd you and to guide you to your desired haven. There's a desired heaven for every one of us on this earth regarding some things that we are believing God for. There's a desired heaven that even the king himself had for you and I, and that is that he will guide us home safely. That is why he came. And so David said, what? He leadeth me beside the still water. He leads me in the path of righteousness. So he guides, the sheep guides us to walk righteously. The shepherd guides us in order for us to walk on that path that will lead to life. No wonder in the narratives of the birth of Jesus Christ, we saw the three wise men being guided by the star. They reached what their desired heaven. Joseph had four dreams that God used to order his footsteps. The shepherd was there guiding him. If Jesus did not come looking for us, we would have been lost forever. Thank God that he came to look for us. Isaiah 53 verse 6 says that we all have strayed like sheep. Each one has turned to his own way. So because we have strayed away from his presence, that's why the shepherd came. In order to put us back on the right track and guide us home safely. If not that the shepherd come, we will have been lost without God, lost without hope, lost in the web of sin. But we thank God that he came to shepherd us home. This morning, every one of us needs to consider this king who has come as our shepherd. Remember the son, shepherd our soul, and took control to lead us to where we ought to be. The third reason why the king came was highlighted in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. He said, behold, the virgin shall be with a child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated, God is with us. This same message was the original message of Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Now, if you look at the context of Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, you remember that the king, Isaiah, was the king of Judah. The nation of Israel, there was separation. And then there was another king of the Syrians who joined force with Israel in order to fight Judah. And God sent Isaiah to tell King Ahaziah that, friends, don't be afraid. I'm going to be with you in this battle. These three nations that have come to gather against you will never overcome you. All you need to know is that I am with you. And I will give you a sign. And what is the sign? A virgin will give birth. And that virgin, when the child comes, we will call him Emmanuel. God is with us. But Isaiah was so afraid that he went and made alliance with the Assyrians. And God said, look at you. I gave you my word that I'm going to be with you in your time of war, in your time of pain. But yet, you did not take advantage of what I told you. Now, when Matthew was repeating the same word to us today in the text that we have read, it was a different context, but yet also has similar thing. The Jews were also under oppression. The Roman government was ruling them. Things were not all right. They were not free. And then God sent the word. That in the midst of your pain, in the midst of the chaos, in the midst of the uncertainty, I am with you. And that's why we see that the third reason why the king came, he came to support us and to supply the strength that we need, even in this time. Friends, I do not know what you are going through in this season. I do not know the difficulties that seems to have surrounded you. But God is sending a word to you that I am here to support you. I am here to supply the strength needed for you to overcome all the challenges that might have faced you. And so this morning, this Christmas morning, we'll see the message of the King to you. He said, I am your Emmanuel. I am the God who will stand by you, who will support you. We thank God that we don't have a God who abandons us in a time of difficulties. Remember Elijah and the 400 prophets on the mountain? You know, when Elijah started taunting them, maybe he had traveled. Oh, maybe he has gone to sleep. Can you wake him up? They did all kinds of things. Nothing happened. Oh, their God has traveled. Their God left them in their time of need. But we thank God that we serve a king who will not leave us in our time of difficulties, who will not leave us in our time of pain, who will not leave us when we are at the bedside, who will not leave us when we are at the crossroad, we don't know where to turn to. He is there to whisper, my son, it is well. Beloved, we have a king who has come to support us. Sometimes I used to wonder, why can't you just take away the pain? Why can't you just take away the issues that surround you? Sometimes he will not do it, but he will walk with you. That's why David said, though I walk through the valleys of the shadow of death, say, I will fear no evil because you are with me. Beloved, no matter what you are going through, know that what there's a God who is working with you. I don't know the reason why he's not taking away that matter, but he will supply the strength. He will supply the ability. He will supply the grace. And you will weather through in the name of Jesus. The other day we were looking at the narrative of the birth of Jesus Christ. And we're talking about Herod. And we asked, the thought just came to my mind. When Herod was looking to kill Jesus Christ. And God asked Joseph to carry Jesus and Mary to Egypt. I said, God, why? Why can't you just go and tap Herod and just slap him and he doesn't wake up? Why? Why do you have to trouble your people? Why do you have to trouble? They have to travel from Bethlehem all the way to Egypt because of one man. I said, God, this is unfair. But God said, I am sovereign. I will do what I want to do. But you see, what did God do? God was with them on the journey. They got to their destination safely. You will get to your destination safely. And you will not just get there safely, you will return safely. Because that's what God said, I am with you. The God, Emmanuel, is with us. No matter what the economy is saying, he's with us. Friends, he has been with us. Look at what they were saying, what the whole world, everything was saying. Are we not here now? We are here because of what he is, our Emmanuel. God with us. This Christmas, we are eating chicken. This Christmas, we are eating turkey. In fact, some people are even killing cows. Why? Because God is with us. Our children, look at them. They are wearing new clothes, wearing new shoes, with some kind of strange hat and things, everything. Why? Because God is with us. Beloved, this season is a season to know that the King has come to supply the strength to support us even through this journey. Finally, what is the implication of these three motives of the king? Number one, if Jesus came to save you and I from our sin, our responsibility is to stop sinning. Stop sinning. The Bible says, flee from every appearance of evil. We are in a season where the quantum of sin, you know, I don't know, I don't have any statistical record to show it, but I can visualize that in this Christmas season, the quantum of sin is very much. Why? Because go out there and you see the kind of things that people do. So this Christmas, excuse me, friends, members of this church, is not a time for you to go and drink yourself somewhere. It's not a time to go and do all kinds of evil things. No. The Bible says the reason why he came is to save us from sin. So don't go into sin this season. Don't spoil Christmas with your sin. So our responsibility this time is to flee away from every appearance of evil, every appearance of sin. As believers, we need to know that God Almighty has given us the power and the ability to neutralize the power of sin in our life. You need to take responsibility for that. Secondly, if Jesus came to shepherd us, then it's our responsibility to yield to his guidance. To yield to his guardians, the shepherd. soul? What is it that the Lord has been asking you to do? What is it that a path that he's been showing you to walk in? And it seems you have been struggling with him. No wonder we could sing that song, Shepherd of my soul, I give you full control. Will you allow that song to be your song today? The shepherd of my soul, I give you full control. Wherever you want to lead me to, I am ready to go with you. That's our responsibility this season, to follow the shepherd, to listen to the shepherd, to respond to the shepherd, to yield to the shepherd, to submit to the shepherd, because he's guiding you somewhere. If you follow this shepherd, you can never miss your way. If you follow this shepherd, there's a place that he has prepared even for you and I. And then lastly, if Jesus came to support us and to supply the strength needed, then we also need to share. We need to share with some who are going through difficulties at this time. If Jesus came to support you and I, then we also need to support somebody today. So in the midst of our merriment, please remember somebody, maybe a neighbor, maybe a friend somewhere, maybe some colleague somewhere who are going through some pains. Can you spend some time with them? Can you spend some time to just pray with them? Because he came to support us, then we also need to support somebody even at this moment. Please, let's close our eyes as we pray. I don't know which one is your own. Maybe it's a matter of sin that you need to deal with. Maybe it's a matter of the shepherd that you need to yield to. Maybe you need support. I don't know which one is your own. But the Lord has spoken to us that this king came with these three motives: in order to save us from sin, in order to shepherd us, and in order to support us in our pain. Will you pray this morning? Will you yield yourself to him? Will you ask him to help you? Do you want him to shepherd you? You want to yield to the shepherd this morning? The Lord is calling you to come to the altar. We want to pray with you. We want to pray with you this morning, this Christmas morning, the last Sunday of this year. Why can't you make it a remarkable day where you just yield totally to the shepherd and say, Lord, I am giving up all to you this morning. The shepherd is calling you. The shepherd is calling you. The shepherd is calling you. Please, will you come? Will you come this morning? You were making a decision to yield yourself to the shepherd, to say, Lord, I've been trying to do it on my own. It's not ending well. But to this morning, I know that you are the shepherd of my soul, and I know you will guide me to my desired heaven. Please, will you come? We want to pray with you. Pastor is going to come now to come and pray with us, to come and commit us into the hands of God. Are you struggling with sin? The Lord is saying, come this morning. He's going to give you grace to overcome those sins in his presence.
Mighty Father, we give you thanks for this visitation by your word. We thank you, O God, because you have charged us today in keeping with the motive of your coming, to stay away from all appearances of evil. Father, we ask, O God, that you grant us the grace to obey your word and do as you have bid us to do, in the name of Jesus. The power of sin that sits like a yoke over us, may it be broken in the name of Jesus. I'd like to ask, O eternal Father, that Jesus Christ, who is the righteousness of God in us, begin to reign in us today, O God, and henceforth, in the name of Jesus. We pray, eternal God, that you give us power to surrender completely to you and yield unto you as our shepherd. Help us, O eternal Father, to be obedient sheep. We are the sheep of your pasture. Grant, O God, that we'll be where you have put us and go where you ask us to go. Help us to listen to your voice. The Bible says the voice of a stranger we will not pay attention to. Father, grant that no strange voice will appeal to us, but the voice of our shepherd will be our portion, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we do pray today that, Lord, you help us to go out there and declare the Lordship of Jesus and tell of the good news of your salvation and to share with people who have not yet known you the good news of salvation, and also bring them into a taste of what you have done in our lives, O God. The goodness we have enjoyed throughout the period since we came to know you. We pray, eternal God, that this you will do for us in the name of Jesus. Thank you, eternal Father, for your servant whom you have used today to bring your word to us. We ask, O God, that you renew his strength, grant him understanding, deeper understanding of your revelation, and help us, O God, that we shall continue to pray for him, and that as we pray for him and yield to the word that you give through him, O God, we shall become a better congregation. Thank you, Father, for this beautiful morning. Glory be unto you. As we switch over to the communion table, on this last Sunday of the month and last Sunday of the year, how we do pray that your presence will continue with us, that these elements that we are receiving today, we'll receive them with joy and thanksgiving. Father, may they be a blessing to us in the name of Jesus. God, we want to still pray today and ask, O God, that we will not eat this unto our own condemnation, but we shall eat it, O God, unto our justification in the name of Jesus. Thank you, blessed Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's celebrate the Lord. Let's put our hands together and appreciate God's word that we have received.